Hello. This presentation emphasises how extremely sinister and dangerous the savage instinct's excuse for human behaviour is. In video 10, titled "What Exactly is the Human Condition?", I described how fearful we humans have been of the previously unexplained issue of our species corrupted and fallen, innocence destroyed, Garden of Eden abandoned human condition, and how our distant ape ancestors came to live in a completely cooperative, loving, innocent, Edenic moral state of is explained in Freedom Essay 21, and you can also read many wonderful descriptions of this time and innocence in Freedom Essay 53. So yes, in video 10, I talked about how all our thoughts and actions have been monopolized by our great fear of the issue of our corrupted, innocence-destroyed human condition. I described how we have spent almost all of our adult lives working out and perfecting how to avoid the issue of the human condition. How we even tried to make it appear as though we weren't affected by the issue, smiling and joking and generally putting on a brave face. Basically, the minds of resigned adult humans have been committed to avoiding any thinking that might bring them into contact with the, until now, unexplained issue of the human condition. And I might mention the psychological process of resignation that adolescents go through to living in denial of the human condition is explained in Freedom Essay 30. Now, it follows that since scientists are humans suffering from the human condition like everyone else, they too will have been living in fearful denial of the human condition. And clearly, such avoidance has been a very serious handicap in their line of work, because if you can't confront a subject, you're in no position to think truthfully and effectively about it. And since the study of behaviour is a province of biology, it follows that the all-important task of explaining and understanding human behaviour, most especially the crux issue of our good and evil conflicted human condition, has been the particular responsibility of biological scientists. However, given this, their inability to confront and think truthfully about any subject that brought the issue of the human condition into focus, which is almost all subjects to do with human behaviour, we can expect that very little truthful understanding of human behaviour has emerged from biology. And as we will now see, that has indeed been the case with extremely serious consequences. In 1859, the great biologist Charles Darwin wrote The Origin of Species, which shed light on the origin of the variety of life on Earth. It is a seminal work that has been voted the most influential book in history, but even so, it stops short of tackling the origin of the one species we really needed to understand, namely us humans. In fact, humans are hardly even mentioned in The Origin of Species. And Darwin readily admitted this shortfall because at the end of The Origin of Species, he said, "In the distant future, I see open fields for far more important research. Light will be thrown on the origin of man and his history." This reluctance by Darwin to tackle the origin of man and his history was an understandable and honest response given what has just been explained about how unbearably self-confronting and depressing the subject of human behaviour has been for virtually everyone. I mean, as the Cambridge scholar, I think it's Jane Ellen Harrison has written, "Darwin foresaw that his doctrine must have for the history of man's mental evolution issues wider than those with which he was prepared personally to deal with." Here I give a much more detailed description of Darwin's avoidance of the human condition in paragraph 188 of my book Freedom. Now, Not all biologists, however, have been as scrupulous as Darwin. Despite not being able to confront the human condition, many have put themselves forward as objective thinkers about human behaviour, with the result being that all manner of dishonest supposed explanations have been put forward for almost every aspect of human behaviour. I mean, a great industry of dishonest biology has developed around the subject of human behaviour. And as I'll now explain, all this dishonesty has been based on the savage animal instinct's excuse for our selfish and aggressive behaviour. This excuse that we humans have brutish and savage instincts is one virtually everyone has been subscribing to. I mean, our conversations are saturated with the savage instincts-based reason for our competitive, selfish and aggressive human condition-afflicted behaviour, with comments like, we're pre-programmed by our genes to try to dominate others and be a winner in the battle of life. And our preoccupation with sexual conquest is due to our primal instinct to sow our seeds. And men behave abominably because their bodies are flooded with must-reproduce their genes promoting testosterone. And we want a big house because we are innately territorial and fighting in war is just our animal nature expressing ourselves. However, as I pointed out in the second video in this introductory series, the savage must reproduce our genes instincts explanation for our competitive, selfish, and aggressive behaviour is a completely dishonest lie. Firstly, we humans have cooperative, selfless and loving moral instincts, the voice or expression of which in us is we call our conscience, which is the complete opposite of competitive, selfish and aggressive instincts. As Darwin recognised, the moral sense perhaps affords the best and highest distinction between man and the lower animals. And in order to have an altruistic moral instinctive nature, our distant ancestors must have been cooperative and loving, not competitive and aggressive like other animals. Freedom Essay 21 and Chapter, 5 of Freedom explain that we acquired our extraordinary altruistic moral instincts through nurturing. And it's described there how bonobos, which is a variety of chimpanzee that lives south of the Congo River in Africa, are a living example of a species who are achieving this completely cooperative, selfless and loving state through nurturing. And I think it's Freedom Essay 22, you can read about the fossil evidence for this cooperative, selfless and loving past. And the second point I made was descriptions of human behaviour such as egocentric, arrogant, inspired, depressed, deluded, pessimistic, optimistic, artificial, hateful, cynical, mean, immoral, brilliant, guilt-ridden, evil, psychotic, neurotic, and alienated, all recognize the involvement of our species' unique, fully conscious thinking mind, that they make it clear that there's a psychological dimension to our behavior. We humans have suffered not from a genetic opportunism-based, non-psychological animal condition, but the conscious mind-based, psychologically troubled human condition. And most importantly, as we will see, psychosis can be healed with understanding. So our psychologically upset human nature is fixable or changeable, not unchangeable, which is what it would essentially be if our competitive, selfish and aggressive nature was instinctive. If it was something that's in our genes that we are born with. The actual explanation for how we humans became psychologically upset sufferers of the angry, egocentric and alienated human condition was presented in video 3. What caused the upset was a clash between our original innocent, Edenic, cooperative and loving moral instincts and the emergence of our fully conscious mind. So yes, we have cooperative and loving instincts, not savage, competitive and aggressive ones. I might mention that you can read a detailed explanation of what instincts and consciousness actually are in paragraphs 247 to 248 of Freedom. Also, Freedom Essay 24 explains how we humans became fully conscious when other animals haven't. What has been so extremely dangerous about the completely dishonest savage instincts excuse is how seductive it has been. I mean, when it came to avoiding the truth of our psychologically upset human condition, which is emphasized all resigned adults have been committed to doing, the savage animal instincts excuse for our behavior could hardly have been more seductive, because instead of our instincts being all loving as they actually are, they are made out to be vicious and brutal. And instead of our conscious mind being the seemingly destructive cause of our species' corrupted so-called fall from grace, the cause of our departure from our species' original Garden of Eden state of innocence, as was the case, it was made out to be the blameless mediating hero who had to try to control those supposed savage instincts within us. I mean, rather than our instincts appearing to be good and our angry, egocentric and alienated conscious mind appearing to be bad because it, in effect, caused the corruption of our original innocent state, which is the true description of what happened, our instincts were made out to be bad and our conscious intellect to be good, which, while fabulously relieving of our conscious mind's immense guilt for having destroyed the innocent world of our instinctive self or soul, was a complete reverse of the truth lie. The truth is our ape ancestors were innocent, loving nurturers. Here's an unusually honest depiction by paleo artist J. Matinez of the 4.4 million year old Ardipithecus ramidus that appeared in the journal Science in 2009, which truthfully shows our ancestors with an innocent, non-aggressive look or demeanor. I mean, our ancestors were not the savage, barbaric brutes they have for so long been portrayed as being in pictures like this one. In fact, as this painting by Jean-Michel Bisquet depicts, it's us humans now who are psychotic, angry, egocentric and alienated, seemingly evil monsters. And interestingly, this 1982 painting sold in 2017 for $110 million, which at the time was the sixth most expensive artwork ever sold at auction. No doubt because of its extraordinary honest portrayal of the true nature of our present horrifically psychologically upset human condition. What now has to be described is just how enormous the ramifications of this lie that we have savage instincts has been. What has happened is that the extreme seductiveness for human condition avoiding resigned humans of dishonestly blaming their corrupted condition on savage instincts has meant that almost all biologists have adopted and perpetuated it. Indeed, as we will now see, this has happened to such an extent that the savage instincts excuse has been used by biologists to dishonestly explain almost every aspect of human behaviour. I'll begin this expose by giving a very brief summary of the history of the main dishonest, savage, instinct-based biological explanations of human behaviour. An in-depth description of this history is presented in chapters 2 and 6 of my book, Freedom. The first dishonest theory for human behaviour to be based on the dishonest, savage, instincts excuse was social Darwinism. This theory misrepresented Charles Darwin's great breakthrough insight of natural selection as a survival of the fittest process. Now, natural selection is the mechanism by which some members of a population reproduce more than others in a given environment. And most significantly, in the first edition of The Origin of Species, which is the book that launched his concept of natural selection, Darwin correctly left it undecided as to whether those individuals that reproduce more could be viewed as winners, as being fitter. However, in later editions, Darwin was persuaded by his associates Herbert Spencer and Alfred Russel Wallace to substitute the term natural selection with the term survival of the fittest. The malignant attraction of this misinterpretation was that it reinforced this dishonest excuse that humans had already been using for our competitive and aggressive behaviour, which is that our forebears weren't cooperative and loving, but competitive and aggressive savages preoccupied with survival and domination of each other like other animals. And that we in the sense being our conscious thinking self, are the blameless heroes having to try to control those supposed savage instincts in us. As I've said, since it was the emergence of our conscious mind that led to the corruption of our species' original cooperative and loving instinctive life, it was a complete reverse of the truth lie to argue the opposite and claim that our instincts were competitive, selfish and brutal, and our intellect a blameless mediating hero. I should explain that the reason Darwin was honest to leave it undecided as to whether those who reproduce more are fitter is because, as I explain in Freedom Essay 25 and in paragraph 358 of Freedom, I think, being unconditionally selfless, where you give your life to help others and don't seek to reproduce more, can be a biologically meaningful fitter outcome. To briefly explain why it can be meaningful, as is explained in Freedom Essay 23, the meaning of existence is to develop ever larger and more stable wholes of matter. So atoms came together to form molecules, which came together to form compounds, which in turn integrated or came together to form single-celled organisms, which form multicellular organisms, which form societies, and so on. And unconditionally selfless self-sacrifice for the good of the whole is the very theme of this integrative process because it maintains wholes. I mean, selfishness is divisive and disintegrative, while selfless consideration of others to maintain wholes is integrative. I mean, the fact that the gene-based natural selection process cannot normally develop unconditionally selflessness between sexually reproducing individuals because obviously selfless traits don't tend to reproduce, is simply a limitation of the gene-based learning system. Integrative selflessness is the real characteristics of existence, the very theme of life, hence its meaningfulness. Now, the problem that emerged with social Darwinism's dishonest excuse that animals are selfish and preoccupied with domination, and that's why we are selfish and preoccupied with achieving as much dominating power, fame, fortune, and glory as we can, is that it didn't account for humans' unconditionally selfless, altruistic moral instincts, the voice of which, as I've said, is our conscience. But undeterred by this failing, it was that master of human condition avoiding dishonest biology, the much acclaimed Harvard University-based biologist Edward O. Wilson. I mean, he's been wrongly described as the living heir to Darwin and even as the world's greatest scientist, who contrived an even more dishonest solution to this problem. All still based on the dishonest, must reproduce your genes, selfish and nasty instincts excuse. So in his momentous 1975 book, Sociobiology, The New Synthesis, Wilson acknowledged selfless moral behaviour in humans, but argued that it's really only a subtle form of selfishness, where we are indirectly promoting the reproduction of our genes by fostering others who are related to us. As Wilson said about this moral soul-denying kin selection theory, as it's been called, which became known as evolutionary psychology. Morality has no other demonstrable function other than to ensure human genetic material will be kept intact. Even saying that the philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau claimed that humanity was originally a race of noble savages in a peaceful state of nature who were later corrupted. But what Rousseau invented was a stunningly inaccurate form of anthropology, so he completely denied our cooperative heritage. In time, it became accepted that while kin selection does explain the cooperative behaviour of animals like ants, it doesn't actually acknowledge and explain human moral nature. I mean, as the journalist Brian Appleyard pointed out, biologists still have a gaping hole in an attempt to explain altruism. If, for example, I help a blind man across the street, It is plainly unlikely that I am being prompted to do this because he is a close relation and bears my genes. And the world is full of all sorts of elaborate forms of cooperation which extend far beyond the boundaries of mere relatedness. To contrive a solution to this problem, Wilson then, in his 2012 book, The Social Conquest of Earth, put forward the absolutely outrageously dishonest multi-level selection theory for eusociality, which means genuine sociality. Where previously Wilson had limited himself to getting rid of the truth of our all-loving, original, instinctive self or soul, he now set about using lies to dispose of the great overarching main problem facing humankind, of the human condition itself. I mean, the brazenness of this assault is evident in the first sentence of the Social Conquest of Earth, which reads, "There is no grail more elusive or precious in the life of the mind than the key to understanding the human condition." And yes, the human condition is the holy grail of the whole human journey. But what Wilson does is not provide the most precious grail in the life of the mind, as his opening sentence suggested he was going to do. Rather, he sets about nullifying the chance of it ever being found, and by so doing commits humanity to extinction. I mean, pure hypocrisy. Hypocrisy, the absolute possible worst kind. Basically, the multi-level selection theory argues that along with supposed competitive survival of the fittest, must reproduce your own genes, selfish instincts, we humans also have operating at another level, some cooperative, selfless and moral instincts derived from so-called group selection. These selfless instincts supposedly countering evolutionary psychology's denial of the existence of humans' unconditionally selfless moral instincts. Now, the truth, which Wilson tries to bluff his way past by claiming that effective warfare depended on group cooperation, is that the idea of group selection giving rise to selfless instincts has been fully discredited on the grounds that any selflessness that develops within a group will be constantly exploited by cheaters. I mean, by all means, help me reproduce my genes, but I'm not about to help you reproduce yours. The biologist Jerry Coyne pointed this logic out when he wrote that group selection for altruism would be unlikely to override the tendency of each group to quickly lose its altruism through natural selection favouring cheaters. So according to Wilson, our ability to war successfully somehow produced our ability to love unconditionally, which is ridiculous. Overall, while the multi-level selection theory added unconditionally selfless instincts to selfish instincts in the mix of what allegedly forms our species' instinctive makeup, in essence, it still amounted to a continuation of the same old reverse of the truth, escape rather than confront the human condition agenda, that humans have villainous selfish instincts and a blameless conscious mind that has to step in and control them. As I've mentioned, what is outrageous and extremely dangerous is how Wilson used the multi-level selection theory to supposedly explain what he described, a grail, which is the most precious in the life of the mind of the human condition. Saying in The Social Conquest of Earth that individual selection is responsible for much of what we call sin, while group selection is responsible for the greater part of virtue. Together they have created the conflict which the poor, between the poorer and better angels of our nature. In summary, Wilson asserted that the dilemma of good and evil was created by multi-level selection. I mean, a clever semblance of our conflicted condition, diabolically clever, but entirely untrue. So, according to Wilson, rather than having an original, completely, unconditionally selfless, altruistic, moral, instinctive self or soul, which we then corrupted when we became conscious and developed an upset, angry, egocentric and alienated psychosis, which is the true description of the origin of our condition, Wilson says we simply have some instincts that want us to behave selflessly and some that don't. while a virtuous, better angels, good part of ourselves exists in Wilson's, we have some selfless instincts account. There's no guilt from our conscious mind's corruption of our completely selfless moral soul. What this means is that Wilson's account of the human condition is non-judgmental, in the sense that there's no real values, no notion of the absolutes of good versus evil or right versus wrong in the true moral sense. I mean, what a relief for guilt-stricken humans, but what an incredible fraud. I mean, what Wilson has done with his non-psychological, no guilt-stricken conscious mind involved account is not explain the human condition at all, but nullify it, render the issue benign, virtually inconsequential. And in doing so, he is effectively burying humanity a long way underground, in Plato's analogy, in the deepest, darkest depths of Plato's cave of denial, that, which I described in video 11. I provided clear evidence that Wilson's multi-level selection theory is nothing but an outrageously dishonest contrivance, contrived excuse for our condition, when in video 4 I referred to the many great thinkers in history who have recognized the instinct versus intellect elements involved in producing our psychologically distressed human condition. We even saw in, was it Freedom Essay 10, how the great 19th century poet William Blake recognised that our distressed condition is a result of a clash between the two contrary states of our innocent, lamb-like, cooperative and loving moral instinctive heritage and our experience-based conscious mind. And much more evidence of just how obvious the instinct versus intellect explanation for the human condition is when someone is prepared to think honestly and truthfully about it, about the subject, is presented in Freedom Essay 53. Again, chapter 2 and 6 of Freedom provide an in-depth description of this history of the dishonest, savage, instinct-based biological explanations, supposed explanations anyway, for human behaviour. What I now need to explain is that the most dangerous use by far that has been made of the savage instincts excuse is its use in justifying the dogmatic imposition of good or correct cooperative and loving behaviour on our supposedly competitive and aggressive, unchangeable, innate, born-with instincts. The basis of left-wing political philosophy is that since we humans supposedly have unchangeable savage instincts, then it argues that it follows that we have no choice but to dogmatically impose good or correct cooperative and loving behaviour on those supposedly unchangeable competitive and aggressive instincts. Once this excuse that we have savage animal instincts that we are born with and therefore can't change is accepted, then the left-wing, politically correct movement's imposition of dogma is justified, but as emphasised, that underpinning savage animal instincts explanation is wrong. So the fundamentals of the left-wing's philosophy is completely wrong. Again, as I explained in video 3, ours is a psychologically troubled condition, a psychosis. And understanding can heal a psychosis. So we need understanding, which is the opposite of mindless, blind dogma. In fact, idealistic, politically correct dogma oppresses the search for knowledge because it stifles the freedom to be, to a degree, competitive, aggressive and selfish, which, as the Adam Stork story in video 3 reveals, was the price we humans had to be prepared to pay for searching for knowledge, ultimately for self-knowledge, for the reconciling, redeeming and psychologically transforming understanding of the human condition. So stopping the upsetting search for knowledge stopped us from achieving freedom from our upset, angry, egocentric and alienated condition. Politically correct dogma worked against our species achieving freedom from the human condition. Paradoxically, instead of bringing about the cooperative and loving, ideal, correct world it promoted itself as doing, left-wing dogma was leading humanity straight to extinction because it was stopping the all-important search for knowledge that would liberate us from our condition. It was not progressive as it liked to describe itself. It was regressive. That's the phenomenal importance and power of the Adam Stork story in video 3. It finally explains that there was a vital, all-important, good reason for the angry, egocentric, and alienated upset in humans. It explains and defends our immensely upsetting but immensely heroic search for knowledge. The problem has been that the longer the upsetting search for knowledge, as I said, ultimately for understanding of the human condition, went on, the more upset, angry, egocentric, and alienated the human race became. That being the consequences of the searching for knowledge. And in the end, what happened was that the human race became so psychologically exhausted by the upsetting search, so overly angry, egocentric, and alienated, that many couldn't resist the relief of giving up that upsetting search and siding with the cooperative and loving world of our instincts. In the Adam Stork analogy, ever-increasing numbers of humans ended up just wanting to fly back on course and obey the cooperative ideals of our instincts, abandon the honest reality of humanity's predicament of having to participate in the great heroic upsetting battle to find knowledge, and instead chose an irresponsible, unrealistic, and dishonest life of cowardice, basically, where they just bask in the feel-good relief of behaving in a cooperative ideal correct way and signal to the world that they are virtuous. I mean, they no longer wanted to pursue the all-important but upsetting search for knowledge, ultimately for self-knowledge, understanding the human condition, that is required to actually bring an end to the ever-increasing upset and psychosis in the world. Basically, they have been voting for the death of the human race from terminal levels of psychosis, because unless the fully accountable, truthful understanding of the human condition was found, as thankfully it now is, that upset psychosis was only going to continue increasing. That is the truth. Proponents of left-wing philosophy have been advocating that the human race perish in a writhing heap of indescribable psychotic agony. And to cope with that, epidemic levels of autistic detachment and dissociation. And that state of terminal alienation for the human race is very rapidly approaching. In Freedom Essay 55, I describe this terrible endgame state that the human race has now entered. The great philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche perfectly understood the crisis that is upon us when he wrote this amazing description of the endgame stage of humanity's great journey from ignorance to enlightenment. There have always been many sickly people among those who invent fables and long for God. Long for ideality. They have a raging hate for the enlightened man and for that youngest of virtues which we call honesty. Pure and more honest of speech is this healthy bodies, perfect and square built, and it speaks of the meaning of the earth, which is to fight for knowledge, ultimately for self-knowledge, understanding of the human condition. You are not yet free. You still search for freedom. Your search has fatigued you. But by my love and hope I entreat you, do not reject the hero in your soul. Keep holy your highest hope. War, and against the oppression of dogma, and courage have done more great things than charity. Not your pity, but your bravery have saved the unfortunate up till now. What warrior wants to be spared? I do not spare you. I love you from the very heart, my brothers in war. It needs to be emphasized that what Nietzsche means by war is the underlying battle against oppression from the condemnation of our moral, correct, behaviour insisting, dogmatic, ignorant, instinctive self or soul. In another of his books, Beyond Good and Evil, Nietzsche similarly wrote, "There comes a time in a culture's history when it becomes so pathologically soft that it takes the side of its worst enemy, which is non-understanding, unquestioning, dogmatic idealism, and calls it progress." Yes, while it wasn't wrong to rest from the upsetting battle to find knowledge, ultimately to find self-knowledge, understanding of the human condition, when we became overly angry, egocentric, and alienated, indeed, rest and recuperation have been vital. What was false and dangerously misleading was the claim that abandoning the battle was the way to win the battle and the path to follow, which is what the culture of the left wing in politics has effectively been deludedly and dogmatically insisting happen. I mean, compassion and kindness towards those who are suffering or less fortunate was very important. But as Nietzsche said, we had to keep holy our highest hope of achieving the meaning of our existence, of finding enlightening understanding of ourselves. We humans needed reconciling, healing and transforming understanding of our psychologically upset and distressed human condition. Not mindless, answerless, straitjacketing, dogmatic discipline of that upset state. We needed to be able to think our way to sanity, not abandon thinking and just behave like brain-dead robots. We conscious thinking humans needed brain food, not brain anaesthetic. We needed answers. Debraining ourselves, giving up thinking, just dogmatically insisting that everyone be good is fraudulent and gets us nowhere. In fact, it leads the human race straight to extinction. The only way, the only thing that gets us out of the human condition is understanding of the human condition. But the left-wing culture is all about giving up on finding understanding. I mean, Karl Marx, the political philosopher whose mid-19th century theories gave rise to socialism and communism, was wrong when he said that the philosophers have only interpreted the world in various ways. The point is not to understand the world, but to change it. I mean, by change it, Marx meant just make it cooperative or social or communal. But he was wrong. The whole point and responsibility of being a conscious being is to understand our world and place in it, ultimately to find understanding of the human condition. So that is how precious the fully accountable explanation of the human condition is in freedom. In the nick of time, it is able to stop this mad left-wing Marxist march to a death by dogma end for the human race. Freedom Essay 34 and 35 provide a more in-depth description of why the culture of the left wing is fundamentally flawed, and Freedom Essay 36 adds even more description of the left wing's misuse of the false savage instinct biology and its extremely dangerous consequences. What I want to conclude this presentation with is a description of just how far the left wing has now gone in using the savage instincts justification for its culture. A 2012 article titled "The Left Uses Evolution to Explain Everything" by the American journalist and author Dennis Prager describes how the left wing has adopted the dishonest savage instincts excuse to the extent that they're now using it to justify every aspect of their culture. Prager warned of the danger involved in allowing the left to use science and evolution in particular to empower government to coerce its citizens. I mean, to as just explained, comply with their politically correct culture of having to impose idealism on our supposed savage instincts. Prager added, evolution is offered as the left's explanation for virtually everything. Evolution explains love, altruism, morality, economic behaviour, God, religion, intelligence. But I'll just break these down. It argues that love is due to a need to reproduce our genes, but in Freedom Essay 27, I give the real explanation for love. And in the case of altruism and morality and economic behaviour, the false biological theories I've just described would have us believe that these aspects of a behaviour are all supposedly driven by a need to reproduce our genes. Well, Freedom Essay 21 provides the real nurturing explanation for our moral instincts. In the case of God and religion, both are supposedly a result of the need to be controlled so we can better reproduce our genes. But Freedom Essay 23 gives a real explanation of God, and Freedom Essay 39 provides the real psychological explanation for religion. In the case of intelligence, it supposedly has developed from the need to manage complex social situations so we can better reproduce our genes. But the real explanation for how we humans became conscious is presented in Freedom Essay 24. As one example of this misuse of dishonest science, Prager referred to the assertion by the left that those who do not support same-sex marriage are not recognised in the indisputable scientific fact that homosexuality is a natural phenomenon. Now, this is a classic illustration. Claiming that sex humans practice is no different from the sex animals practice when they try to reproduce their genes. But the truth, as explained in chapter 8.11b of Freedom and summarised in Freedom Essay 27, is that sex as humans practice it, including homosexuality, is a result of being psychologically upset. So there's no relationship between the homosexuality that occurs in animals and the homosexuality that occurs in humans. Again, our behaviour is psychosis-driven. So this is a classic illustration of the left's misuse of dishonest science. They've taken this false savage instincts excuse for human behaviour and said it explains explains homosexuality in humans, and used that assertion to defend same-sex marriage. We see this particular dishonest biology that everything about human sexual relationship is due to a need to reproduce our genes everywhere. For example, it's claimed that men are attracted to younger women because they're more fertile and will more successfully reproduce our genes, when it's the innocence or innocence appearance of younger women that makes them more attractive for human psychosis-driven sexual destruction, which is explained in Freedom Essay 27. So the left wing is using dishonest science to support all its positions. As Prager says, to differ with the left is not only definitionally sexist, intolerant, xenophobic, homophobic, Islamophobic, racist and bigoted. It's now against science itself. I mean, this is how insidious left-wing culture is. And again, it's all coming off this completely false idea that we have savage animal instincts. As Prager says, the left are using science as a tool to dictate what is to be tolerated and what is to be mocked. Most significantly, Prager's article also said that the left has always sought single, non-value-based explanation for human behaviour. And the absence of absolutes, good versus evil, right versus wrong. And that's what the left claim they have with E.O. Wilson's dishonest human condition avoiding multi-level selection theory. As I've described, the multi-level selection theory is supposedly a non-values-based, non-judgmental system that dishonestly says that we don't suffer from a psychologically troubled human condition. Rather, through the use of the dishonest group selection theory, it just argues that, okay, along with selfish instincts, we do have some selfless instincts. It's a complete belittling of what our instinctive self or soul is, and a complete and dangerous dismissal of our psychosis. Everything that's true and important about humans is completely butchered, destroyed by these dishonest arguments. The truth, which because it's so serious, I reiterate in Freedom Essay 36, which is about saving Western civilization from the religion of left-wing dogma, and in Freedom Essay 40, which explains Judgment Day, is that all of biology now is a great fraud, as is virtually every other branch of science, because they are all infected by this dishonest, mechanistic, biological thinking. All our universities are really just ivory towers of intellectual dishonesty, just castles of lies, as Plato so accurately described the situation, which I referred to in video 11. Everyone's hiding in a dark cave of dishonest denial. So all there is to read now is just cave speak rubbish, and it has all just culminated in a dangerous takeover of the world by dogma, which is the greatest threat the world has ever seen, given what was really needed was freedom of expression and the search for knowledge that it made possible. The human race has entered the darkest era the world has ever known, the ultimate dark age. And before long, the death by dogma extinction of the human race. Again, Freedom Essay 55, which is the end game for the human race, presents an accurate description of how serious the situation is. In summary, what we in the World Transformation Movement, or WTM, are providing is a psychosis addressing and solving real explanation of the human condition. What the left wing have been putting forward is only an imitation of a human condition-free world. And because its pseudo-artificial imitation suppresses the search for knowledge needed to actually bring about a human condition-free world, it has been leading the way not to freedom from the human condition, as it deludes itself and arrogantly proclaims to the world it's doing, but leading us away from it. The philosophy of the left wing is an extremely dangerous con job, a malignant fake. The actual biological explanation of the human condition that we in the WTM are presenting is genuinely non-value based. Because the explanation of the Adam Stork story does actually eliminate forever the notion of good versus evil. It acknowledges that we're psychologically upset, but explains there's a good reason for why we became upset. So it does actually remove guilt. It provides the real absence of absolutes, good versus evil, right versus wrong explanation. Those concepts have been dismantled truthfully and genuinely and actually, because the old defensive and insecure, angry, eccentric and alienated power, fame, fortune and glory ways of justifying ourselves are now obsoleted by this real biological explanation of ourselves. The real understanding of the human condition we are presenting actually brings about the now absolutely desperately needed and 2 million year hungered for transformation of the human race. The final important point to emphasise is that now that we have the fully accountable real explanation of the human condition, we can at last explain and understand that while the right wing and the left wing were both using the dishonest savage instincts biology to justify their philosophies, the right wing was using it in the cause of good, namely in support of the upsetting search for knowledge, while the left wing was using it in the cause of what was bad, indeed extremely dangerous, namely in blocking and even determinedly opposing that all-important upsetting search for knowledge. The enormous benefit of this clarifying insight is that while it hasn't been possible to halt the terrifying human race-destroying left-wing politically correct tide of dogma taking over the world, we now have the insight needed to stop it. We can now finally clearly explain what is so wrong and dangerous about the left wing's culture. So that is what's so precious about this presentation. And in Freedom Essays 34, 35 and 36, which elaborate on this presentation. Of course, Freedom chapters 8:15 and 8:16, which present the definitive explanation of what's wrong with the culture, the left-wing culture, are the most precious of all. So yes, ultimately, heroic efforts to explain and justify right-wing politics by the likes of Ayn Rand and most recently Jordan Peterson were doomed to fail because their arguments were still based on the biologically dishonest social Darwinist savage instincts excuse for human behaviour. That we humans have are innately competitive, aggressive and selfish. I mean, Rand believed we have to use our mind to effectively manage a selfish nature. And Peterson believes we have a competitive dominance hierarchy-based instinctive heritage. It's only by exposing the lie at the very heart of left-wing philosophy that we could halt and end it. And importantly, not only does the explanation that's being presented here expose and destroy the underpinning argument of left-wing politics, by providing the psychosis addressing and solving real explanation of the human condition, the actual, real, true, and authentic way to end all the competitive and aggressive behaviour of humans and transform the human race is being provided. As summarised in paragraph 136 of Freedom, that is the final irony of the saga of humanity's great journey from ignorance to enlightenment. the ideal world that the left wing has been dogmatically demanding is actually brought about by the right wing winning its reality defending, freedom from idealism, corrupting search for knowledge battle against the freedom-oppressing pseudo-idealistic dogma of the left wing. With the freedom from dogma right-wing search for understanding of the human condition completed by the finding of understanding of the human condition, the justification for the egocentric power, fame, fortune, and glory-seeking way of life espoused by the right-wing ends, replaced by ideal behaviour-obeying attitude that the left-wing sought. In this sense, when the right wing wins, we all become left wing. Through the success of the philosophy of the right wing, we all adopt the ideal values sought by the philosophy of the left wing. But most significantly, this time we are not abandoning and opposing an upsetting ongoing battle. We are leaving it won. So this is how the seemingly intractable cultural war between left and right wing politics finally plays out. Basically, the whole horrible business of politics is brought to an end and the human race is saved. But of course, the great death effect block to accessing the all-relieving and all-solving understanding of the human condition, which is a problem I emphasized in the first video and talked further about in the last three videos, still has to be overcome for the human race to actually be saved.